Morning, it's Monday the 13th of March 2017. Now, does that mean that's unlucky? Is like Monday the 13th or any other day like Friday the 13th? Does that mean it's an unlucky day? That's the worry. Maybe I should just stay in here and not touch anything electrical in case I'm electrocuted in front of you. Mind you, that might bring a few more viewers in, mightn't it? You know, if I electrocute myself in front of you all like that. Let's say hello to the early people this morning. Adam's there. Good morning, Adam. Oh, John Springate. I've got something to ask you, John. How funny. I was going to send you a message yesterday. How strange that is. Isn't that strange and mysterious? Yes. I've got something to ask you in a minute, John. Good morning to Paul Dale and Arsenal Mark. You're going to be known as Arsenal Mark now, Mark. Okay, as you work at the Arsenal. Okay, so John, actually, I was going to bring this up later on. Let me see. Do you know, because being a top music man that you are, John Springate was performing in the Glitter Band, ding 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 ding, with his not with his guitar, with his keyboards. I can't remember now. No, with your guitar and all spiky hair and sparkling jackets, weren't you, John? Do you know John is it Mealing? He wrote TV themes. I wondered if you knew him and if you had a contact for him. Because there's a couple of TV themes that I'd really like clean copies of. I mean, you can find them on YouTube. But they've always got like a talk over or someone clapping at the end or someone like that. You know, just something over the top. I'm after a couple of clean copies of for my own personal use. For my personal use. Every second counts. Da 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 da. With that was the one with the magician bloke. Oh dear, Paul Daniels. Excellent, excellent music. And also, he wrote the music to Bob's Full House. Da-da, da-da. No, how's that going? Da-da-da-da. Da-da-da-da. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Master of the House, Bob Monkhouse. But I don't want the talk over. See? Do you know, I think it's John Mealing. Let me just double check that for you, John. One moment, please. John Mealing. Yes, that's it. Look, because I found him on Wikipedia. John Mealing is a keyboards player, composer and arranger. So that's who I'm after. I wonder if he'd, I don't know if they do, if they would sell you a copy of that. It's over 25 years. Oh my word. John, I think I better send you a private message then. I really would, if possible, like two clean copies of that. And I don't know where to go for it. It's not the sort of thing I've got over the years. John, I've collected, you may have heard those two little bits of music. Not quite sure where they're from, to be honest. But when you chuck them through, what's that thing? You know, you press the thing on your mobile. Oh, it's on here. Shazam, that's it. When you chuck it through Shazam, or YouTube, it doesn't come up with anything. So I can't really, I don't really know who wrote those two bits. Oh, yes, I beg your pardon. The first bit, not sure about that one. But the second bit, that was written by David Arnold. You know that one? Da, 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 da. Very powerful number. And I wrote to him. I wrote to him and asked permission if I could use it on the show. And he said, yes, no charge. How fantastic is that? You know? So, I mean, these people are, these very important people in music are kind of open to dialogue, aren't they? You know, when I got a reply from the great David Arnold, wow. I mean, that was just, I bet you've met him as well, haven't you? So that's what I'm after. Maybe I'll send you a little private message later. Thank you, John. Are you in España or are you in UK at the moment, John? Where are you? I mean, I'm still getting... You weren't here Friday, were you, John? Or Saturday? Was it Saturday or Friday? Saturday, I think it was. Oh, no. We had a superstar call in. Oh, yes, dear. A superstar called in on Saturday. The great Nikki French. Don't play that song again. Yeah, she called in. Turn around. Every now and then I feel a little bit and all that business. She called into this tiny little show. Unbelievable, dear. Millions of viewers were enjoying the dulcet tones of Nikki French on Sunday, which was quite nice. It's a beautiful day out there today, boys and girls, by the way. It really is very sunny and nice. I'm going swimming after I've done this. I haven't been swimming it. As you can see, I mean, we are in high definition, boys and girls. No one's noticed anything yet, have they? None of our regulars have noticed anything yet. I'm surprised no one said anything. But there you go. Maybe you will notice something shortly, okay? But I haven't had a shave. Can you see that? I haven't had a shave this morning. Oh, we got a call coming in already. Well, that's funny. We haven't even opened the lines yet. Just a moment. Good morning, line 765. Who's calling in, please?
Oh, good morning. Pobble Doodle Doo. It's Tony here.
Oh, that doesn't sound like Tony Blackburn to me. Tony Blackburn would not... You see, Tony Blackburn would not ring this show, dear. I'm just small, tiny little person in a converted lavatory that is speaking to you this today. He's a big megastar, dear. It would be like receiving a phone call from Barry Manilow.
Well, no, Pobble Doodle Doo, mate. It definitely is Tony here, because I was hearing that you had Nikki French, who I've had on my show, Pick of the Pops, quite a few times. She's great.
I don't mind you changing your voice, but can you take the handkerchief off the phone? Because it sounds like you're talking for a pair of women's knickers.
But it's Tony Blackburn, mate.
It's not Tony Blackburn. I know exactly who that is. I recognise your voice. I recognise a slight commonness in your voice. It's Ross Patzelt.
No, it's Tony Blackburn from BBC Radio 2, 88 to 91 FM.
88 to 91 FM, Radio 2 from the BBC. Da, 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 da. And how can I help you today, Tony?
Well, you were just saying that you wanted pop stars and famous people to ring in, so that's what I've done, Chris. I'm a great fan of your show.
Oh, really? I'm so pleased to hear that. What in particular do you like about the show? And let's be unbiased here, like the BBC, very unbiased. They BBC, nothing to do with Brexit at all. So, do tell us what you like about the show and what you don't like. Carry on.
Well, Bubble Doodle Doo, I do like your mirror ball. I'd quite like one of them in my Radio 2 studio one day.
Well, why don't you just get one? They're not very expensive.
Well, I might quite do that, Pobble Doodle Doo, mate.
I think you should do it. Anything else that you like?
I quite like your silver jacket that you have on sometimes, mate.
I haven't got a silver jacket.
Gold jacket, I mean, mate.
Nope, I haven't got a gold jacket.
The purple jacket? The silvery one, the sparkly one.
I haven't got a sparkly one.
You have, when you do your game show. Oh, when you do your game show thing.
What game show?
Your pop quiz thing. Pobble Doodle Doo quiz, you do it at your pub.
You mean the bingo we used to do?
No, the Union Jack one, mate. The Union Jack.
Oh, the Union Jack one. Yeah, I've got that outside there, yes. I've got that in the cupboard. Do you like that? That was a gift from the lovely non-Irish Mary from Ireland, who often appears and will be appearing tonight in a live karaoke stream from Central Station.
Anyway, Chris, I've got to go because I've got to go and do some adverts.
You're going to go and do some adverts? Well, you carry on then.
Okay. Bubble diddle do, Chris. Love you.
Cheerio. Thanks for calling in, Ross. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Well, that's amazing. How can people call in when the lines aren't even open yet? That's very, very strange and mysterious. I'll stick the phone number up there in a minute. I don't like to put the phone number up too early because sometimes when people immediately ring in and they've got nothing to say. Hello? Oh, hello. Who's that? Yeah. Well, what do you want to talk about? Oh, well, I don't know. So I like to give you something to get going sometimes. Tim, good morning to Tim, who says it's not Tony Blackburn. We would have had the famous laugh. Absolutely was that not Tony Blackburn. Tony Blackburn would not ring in this show, my darlings. He's very, very busy. He's all over the place, isn't he? I suppose, what about it's like being married to Tony Blackburn? Because I'm sure the job would come first. Mind you, that's the case for me, you see. That's why I'm on my own. I always, always put the job first. And that's true, that is. That's not a little joke. That's absolutely true. I always, always put the job first. So there we are. Good morning to Paris, who says, grow a beard. Oh, no, Paris. No, I can't stand those beards. Some of those beards are just awful. I don't mind a little bit of stubble. Like maybe what I've got now. You may have seen pictures of my best mate. That's too much. There's too much there. Just a little bit of stubble, perhaps. That's okay. I don't like a beard. And some of them are so long, these beards. I mean, they must hang down in their food. Very, very unhygienic things, beards. Another call coming in. Good morning to Adam the Plumber. And which part of the world today are you calling in from, Adam? Hello?
Hello.
Hello, it's Her Majesty the Queen here. I've got Adam the plumber here. He's doing some work for oneself.
Oh, what is he doing today, dear? Have you blocked up that toilet again, Your Majesty? Do be careful,
I've had the royal flush.
What? You know, if you use... How can I put this? If you use a little bit too much, put more toilet paper than you usually do, probably best to flush it twice, dear.
Yes, that's right, dear. I think I should.
Or three times.
I'll just pass you over.
Oh, and just before you go, Your Majesty, just before you go, do not put the wet wipes down there. Very, very bad. Very bad. Wet wipes.
You know, it's a little sore bum at this time of the year.
Yes.
Anyway, I will pass you over to Adam, the plumber, and God bless you all and all who sail in you.
Thank you very much. They've all been in me.
Hello, Chris. How are you?
Oh, good morning, Adam. You're busy at Her Majesty's today doing some plumbing, are you?
I thought you'd let me speak to Her Majesty the Queen today. Since you're having all these superstars phoning in this morning.
That's wonderful, that is, Adam. That's really wonderful. Yeah. Go on, what are you calling in about today?
Right, a couple of things. I noticed your set change.
Oh, at last, someone's noticed. Sometimes I wonder if I do these things and no one's taken any notice. You'll notice the mirror ball's gone up. And so, what's happened? Go on, tell me what I've done.
So your mirror ball's gone up by a few inches. Larry has moved from under the clock to above the next to the clock. And the buried picture disc has disappeared at the moment.
The buried picture disc is actually directly behind me.
Oh, right, OK.
Right. Now, do you know why the calendar has been moved to where it is?
To cover up the seam.
Seam, correct. There's a seam there where there's a join in a very, very expensive television set. Now, as you know, there's one up the top as well, but I believe when we're doing the live shows, that is covered by a little red thing. So I don't know what to do there. You know what I think I might like up there? A hanging ivy.
Mm-hmm.
A hanging ivy to trowel down and finish just above Barry's head.
Yep, I'm with you.
So I think that's what I might do there, yeah. And then all the seams are covered then. You can't really see them then, can you?
Mm. I was watching your preview.
Oh, yes, preview, yes.
Your preview, and...
Do you like those little preview videos? Kind of give us a warning that something's about to happen. Because, Wendy, there's been several complaints this week, boys and girls, from Wendy. And Wendy has complained bitterly that sometimes she doesn't get the notifications, which, of course, isn't down to me. So I thought I would try, at least when I remember, to do a little preview video to say something's happening in about 10, 20 minutes' time or so.
That's right. Well,
what have you done to your phone? What have you done to your phone?
I've just got out my van, so I'm probably just a little bit louder now.
Louder? That's an understatement. That sounds really good now. Please do it like that in future. Thank you.
Okay, well, I'm ringing off my old iPhone 60, so that's probably why it's got better quality. Because I know you complain about my iPhone 7 Plus.
The iPhone 7 Plus is terrible.
They really are terrible.
It's not you. It's not you.
I've gone back.
My mate's got
I've
one.
Gone back, to the 6, so
yeah.
I'm going into Apple again actually on probably next Saturday to have it out with them again, because it keeps dropping calls as well and dropping voicemail calls.
Oh really?
Yeah. So and it done this on the other two previous models as well. Let's say I phoned you for instance and it went through to your voicemail. About 20 seconds going into your voicemail, the call just drops, and it's always at 20 seconds into the call.
That sounds more like a network issue.
Well, no, I thought this, and I got a new SIM card, and it still kept on doing it.
Who are you with?
EE.
Oh, very good provider. Very good.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I don't know what I mean.
And I didn't have it, and I put the SIM card into the iPhone 6, the same SIM card into the iPhone 6, and didn't drop the call.
Really? Okay. Actually changed your phone yet?
They've changed it three times. This would be the third one if they change it again.
Oh, my word. Okay.
So I think they've got a problem they're not admitting to, personally.
Yeah. Have you done a little Google search on that?
I haven't yet. No, I'm going to... Because you get a lot of fake news when these new phones
it's all,
come out.
Everything's
you know?
Fake. It's all fake news. Fake news.
It's all fake news, is it?
Oh, dear. Yeah.
So that's that. And the other thing I was ringing about, you asked in your preview about messages that have been sent by mistake.
Yes.
Yes, I sent a message to my friend, one of my best friends once, about an encounter I had the evening before with a young gentleman. And basically, I was describing my evening to my best friend about this evening that I had with this gentleman. And unfortunately, I sent it to everybody in my phone book.
Is that including your mum?
Yep. And it was a little bit explicit in places.
Oh, my God. We don't need to need these dirty little details on this family-based programme. Thank you very much.
Well, I was being very selective on the wording that I was using there. Anyway, Chris, have a lovely day.
Just before you go, before you go, I have received, from Southeast Water, my personalised water use report.
Ooh.
Now, let me just hide my address from the millions of viewers, because they start turning up here, don't they, and trying to...
Exactly, we've had to touch me.
I'm holding this up now. You probably won't be able to see this. But basically, it's like a little graph. At the top is efficient neighbours. Efficient neighbours, which have used 12 metres cubed of water. Is that cubed, M3? Is that cubed?
Yep.
Right, 12 metres. Average neighbours, 25 metres of cubed water, right?
Mm-hmm.
Me, 36 metres of cubed water, and I can't work this out.
Right.
So it says here, just a moment, please. We're pleased to introduce your personal water reports. Where's that bit now? So I'm using more than average.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't work this out. I don't have showers here.
Yep.
I'm not here most of the time. I think there might be a leak somewhere. What do you reckon?
You could possibly have a leak. The best way to test that, Chris, is in the pavement outside you have your meter, don't you?
Oh, yes. Go and look at the meter and see if it's going around.
Go and look at the meter.
Right.
Now, go to your stop valve inside your house.
Yes.
Okay. Go into the stop valve inside your house and turn it off. Then go outside and see if the meter is still turning.
Right.
Because if that is the case, then between the meter and when you turn the water off in your house, you have a leak under the floor.
Now that's not the water people that look after that, is it?
No, and that'd be down to yourself. But your household insurance may cover that. You may be covered under your household insurance for leaks under the floor.
God, expense. You see, because my outside tap thing.
Yep.
What do you call it?
Outside tap.
No, the thing that...
Stop valve.
Is that what... So there's the pipe from the water people that go to a stop cock under the ground, which...
Yeah, that's
you,
right, yep.
Right. What's that called?
That's the stop cock outside.
Okay, the outside stop cock. The outside stop cock to my house, in between, is a little bit of forest, because it's right over the other side. It's not on the pavement outside my house. Yep. You may remember I told you that ages ago. So, I better check that then. I'll try it with my stopcock on, and then I'll try it with... It might be a slow leak, mightn't it?
Yeah, it could be. What you need to do is, when you're not going to be using any water for a minute or two, just turn off the tap inside where it comes in, probably comes in your kitchen, under your kitchen.
Yeah, I know exactly where it is. Yeah. I got the. Yep. I had to have that freed up once because it got jammed. I turn it every few weeks.
Good. Well, turn that off there, and then go and look at your meter and study it for a good couple of minutes, because it may take a minute or two. You'll see on your meter there's a little tiny round red wheel in the middle.
Yes.
Which normally spins.
I know what I'm going to do.
Sometimes I have a dial on it. Depends on the meter, mate.
It's a new one. Brand new. They only replaced it again last year.
Right. Well, there'll probably be a small... In the centre of that, there's a small cog spindle that turns. You'll notice it turns. If that's turning when your water is turned off inside your house, then I would probably say you have a leak under your... between your stock.
Oh, God, expense.
Now, the only other thing is, do you... do you, can you see from any of your overflows, is there any water dripping from anywhere?
No, none.
Right. Have you got, do you know on your toilets, on your two toilets, does water ever drip inside the bowl after you flushed it?
Never.
No, so it's not overflowing then?
No.
So you've got no overflows running by the sounds of it. So the only thing it can possibly be is a leak, or you're doing something that's using more water than your neighbours.
Right, okay.
Whether you leave it.
I can't understand. I'm actually very careful. I don't get left
when
I'm doing teeth brushing or anything like that. So
and
there
you
must
use
be...
the, do you still use the water from the water bottle outside to fill up the toilet?
No, I don't do that anymore. Because I'll tell you why. What would happen is that I was never very careful with the buckets, and half of it would end up on the kitchen floor on the way through.
Right.
But thank you. That's a good idea. Perhaps I should go back to doing that. I find this very difficult to believe how I'm using more than my neighbours.
Yeah,
very,
I mean,
very...
I remember actually years ago talking of water saving there, in Eastbourne in these social houses.
Yeah.
They were brand new state of the art ones. They had. Solar panels on the roof, and they had a big tank in the back garden, like a water tank, underground water tank in the back garden, and that took all the rainwater off the roof, and then it would automatically pump into the toilets, and when it run dry, there'd be a switch that would flick over, and it'd go back onto main water.
Well, that's a good idea.
Yeah, there's that sort of system available. No idea how much it is, but...
Well, I might have to have you install that for me, Adam, the plumber.
Indeed.
That sounds like a good idea. I've actually got two large water butts outside. And, of course, in the winter, they don't get touched. You know, they fill up and then that's it. Yeah. In Australia, in a lot of places in Australia, they don't have mains water. And they actually have a massive tank built underneath the house. And that collects the water. And that's when I was on that place, Norfolk Island, that's how they got their water like that there. Yeah.
I mean, I think you can get, I'm not sure, I think you can get little 12-volt pumps for these water butts. So you can attach a hose and then use them for your garden and use them for filling up toilets, like if you run the hose around
inside windows. Oh, that's interesting. That's interesting to know, because I've got a 12-volt supply out there, haven't I? From the from the solar panel on the tree thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Good.
So there you go. That's your advice for the day.
Well,
from Adam the Plumber, Property and Plumbing Maintenance.
Thank you very much, Adam the Plumber, Plumbing Maintenance Services. How do we get in contact with you, Adam, for your plumbing services, for which you do not charge a call-out fee and you never rip people off? Has anyone ever complained about your price?
You can look me up on Facebook at Adam the Plumber, Facebook / Adam the Plumber. And you can also look me up on, or you can also call me if you like, on 07464 429 067. That's 07464 429 067.
There we are. And I'd just like to point out that that is an unpaid advertisement. We do not advertise on this show. Thank you very much.
That's it.
Cheerio, Adam.
Cheers now, Chris.
Bye now. And well, that's good to know, isn't it? So really, I need to get out there and have a look at my meter to see if that's going round or not. I think actually what I could do, I think the best thing to do is turn the water off in here, then go and go swimming, but take a photograph of the meter when I go out to the swimming pool. When I come back, have another look and check that it's the same. I shall know if there's a leak then or not. We can't be dealing with leaks, dear. No leakies in here. We used to have a boy called Leaky at Scouts. You know when you're at Scouts or in some sort of... children's young people's clubs like that. You all got nicknames, haven't you? Yes, I was Bucktooth. Kind of teeth just stick out like that. I was Bucktooth. And one of my friends, my very, very close friend, was called Leaky, because he always used to get up 3 or 4 times a night to go and have a wee in the field or wherever we were. Leaky, what was your nickname? Did you have a nickname? Huh? Thank you very much for your messages this morning. Good morning to Colin, who's with us this morning. John Springate says, go Android. No, dear. Once you've bought into the Apple things, very difficult to get out of. I've got an iPhone 5S. Now, regular viewers to the show are wondering how I'm showing this to you now, right? Because I used to record the show or do the live stream from this. So it's now all done on the webcam into computer, which also records the show and then goes back up afterwards. So thank you for that, John. Wendy says, I haven't been complaining. Stop telling fibs. Oh, come on, Wendy. It's all a laugh, dear. It's all a laugh. You complain as much as you want, darling. That's what I say. I say to people, usually at karaoke, you feel free to write as many complaints as you want. Write it on toilet paper, and then you know what will happen to it. Wendy says, I hadn't noticed. Yes, we've just moved it round a little bit there. So especially for Wendy, you can see my entire ball revolving slowly in the background, picking up the ambient light here in our massive television studio complex of United Kingdom Talk. Good morning to Rod Brown, who's with us this morning. Tim says, can we get Dave Neese on the phone? If anyone knows Dave Neese, tell him to phone Chris. Who's Dave Neese? I don't know who that is. Who is Dave Neese? I don't know who that is. No. No idea who Dave Neese is. And, Wendy hadn't noticed the seam. Oh, it's there, Wendy. It's a little bit above as well. We need to cover the seam as well, Wendy. Perhaps you've got a suggestion. I'm thinking, trailing ivy. I think that'd be quite nice to go along with our two orchids at the moment. You'll notice the things on here change around now and again. We've got the Dalek today. 1 minute. Oh, it's not working. Oh, no. It was working the other day. Oh, hang on a minute. Oh, dear. 1 minute. Bad news, boys and girls. 1 minute. Look. Do you know what that is? That's battery acid. Oh, dear. Battery acid is coming out of the battery compartment. Oh, I don't think that's going to work anymore. If I start touching that, it'll get all itchy, won't it? Oh, what a shame. Battery acid pouring out, Din. Even worse than the acid coming out of my mouth. Good morning to Mike Cullen, who's with us this morning as well. Now, here's the thing. As you just heard Adam talk about sending a wrong message to someone. Have you ever done that? Have you ever sent the wrong message or wrong picture to the wrong person? Then I'd like you to tell me about it this morning. You can call in. Phone lines are open. 020 8144 3477. That's the phone number. It's a local London number, gang. You are not charged a premium, right? It's not like the 0905 numbers that you have to ring to speak to those lovely ladies. Yes. I bet some of them don't look like they sound. 0905. Call in now. Hi. My name's Josephine. What do you want to talk to me about tonight? It's not like that. It's not like that, I'm afraid. I'm not going to remove any clothes. It's a local London number, 020-8144-3477. There's also a Skype in. If you want to Skype in, my Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. All one word, United Kingdom Talk. And what prompted me to ask you this is the story in this morning's Daily Mail. Many of us have experienced that sinking feeling when we accidentally send a message to the wrong person. Has that ever happened to you? But next time you make an awkward typo, just think to yourself, it could be worse, much worse. At least it hopefully wasn't an explicit text intended for your boyfriend that you accidentally sent to your boss. That's exactly what happened to a few unfortunate employees who shared their blunders on the anonymous secret sharing website Whisper. Now, have you heard of that? Whisper? Never heard of that. Whisper. Like the whispering galleries at St. Paul's Cathedral. I must go there soon. I haven't been there for years. Several others took to the app to share their most awkward messaging mishaps in the workplace, with one accidentally telling their employer how much they despise their job and another even mentioned taking drugs. Can you imagine seeing that? And here comes some of the messages that we have here. Are you ready for that? These are some of the messages. I accidentally sent my boss a nude. Have you ever done that? Come on, tell me. 020-8144-3477. You can do it anonymously if you want to. Let's have a call here from Mike. Good morning, Mike in Newcastle.
Good morning, Chris.
Hello, how are you? All right?
How are you, sir?
Tell me about your dodgy texts and pictures, Mike.
Well, I sent a message to somebody who I thought was a friend on Skype the other day. And we ended up having a conversation about health and politics.
Oh, right.
Believe it or not. So, yeah, that was quite good. That was a long conversation.
But was that the right person? Have you ever sent a message to the wrong person? You know, something a bit saucy, perhaps?
Oh, plenty of times.
Oh, we need to know the details, Mike. We need those details, lovey.
I sent a message to a friend, who I thought was a friend the other day, telling her that I fancied her.
And? And did you get married to her or anything?
No, she just said, I think you've got the wrong person, love.
Oh, disappointing. Mind you, that could be a good way to chat someone up. What you could do is send them a really naughty message. Not necessarily a naughty message. Something like, you know, I've always fancied you and all that. See what comes back. And then if you're rejected, right, you can say, oh, God, I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to send that to you. No embarrassment. What a fantastic way to chat someone up. I might try that myself now. What a good idea. You know, something like, we've known each other for so long.
Yes.
Because I do think best relationships are probably with the people that you've known for a long time. Don't you think?
Definitely.
You know,
definitely.
Rather than those when you meet on Saturday night, wham, bam, you know, then that's it. That's all there is. If you want a long-term relationship, choose someone that you've sort of known for ages and ages, I think. And you could, you know, it's always that thing, you know, do you send them that message or do you make that phone call and risk destroying what you have? You know what I mean?
You could always meet somebody in a game called Second Life if you wanted to.
Second what?
Second Life.
What's that? Are you in your second life now, Mark? Mike? Are you in your second...
Mark?
Are you in a second life now, are you?
No, but I used to be in the game called Second Life.
Right.
which is a game where you become an avatar, you know, and you can sort of go around and do anything you want. You know, it's like having a second life. You know, you can have children, you can have sex with someone. It is so open to anything that you want to do. So if you fancy going into second life to be a DJ or be in real estate or be anything you want to be, then you can.
Well, I didn't know that you played such filthy, disgusting games. I'm very shocked to hear this, Mike.
I don't know, but I used to.
I'm sorry, lovey. There was nothing ever wrong with Pac-Man. Pac-Man is the one that you want to be playing. Boo!
Pac-Man was brilliant, Chris. I used to love Pac-Man.
Oh, we love Pac-Man. We love Pac-Man. But I think that's a very good idea. So you could send someone a message like that, you know, as innocent or as rude as you want, and when they come back and reject you, say, oh my God, I'm really sorry, I didn't mean to send that to you, and then there's no embarrassment of being turned down.
Of course, as long as it's in a game where you you're disguised as this person, this avatar.
I wonder what I could disguise myself as. What would I be?
I think you'd be a knight. I think you'd be a knight.
A knight in shining armor, like the Anglia horse that we don't see anymore.
Because you're that sort of person, aren't you? You're just like shiny and all that. And
am I? Am I shining? Are you sure that's not my head you're looking at?
No, I mean you're just this great person. So I would have you dressed up as a knight.
I hardly class myself as a knight or a great, great person, really. I'm just some sad old bloke sitting in a room talking to himself.
Nah, why not? Why not?
What's it like up in Newcastle today? Is it sunny and nice? It's beautiful here.
It's all right. We've got blue skies at the moment, so it's all right. It's not too bad.
Yeah, it's beautiful here as well, Mike.
It's just a little bit chilly, that's all.
Yeah.
But, I mean, apart from that, it's all right.
Are you on the radio at the moment? Obviously not at this very moment, but, you know, doing something.
I'm trying to get into FM radio. So, yes, I'm trying that at the moment.
Good luck. But if you want to get into that, I'm afraid you'll have to sound like everyone else. They don't want your personality, my friend.
I'll have to sound like Tony Blackburn, won't I?
Oh, except, but he can do anything, can't he? You know, he's got the name. That's the problem you've got. You know, you've got to get the name. I mean, most of 99% of those people that you hear on the radio. I mean, if I read out people's names who are on the radio on some of these stations in London, you wouldn't know who they are. They're not national names. You've got, and I don't know how you would become a national name now anymore. With so many of them going over to automatic and all that business. And more better music. And so if you can say the time and a better music mix every 5 seconds, you might be in with a chance.
A better music mix.
Oh, please don't say that. There's
a lot of people leaving radio, don't you think?
Leaving? No,
radio.
I think I think once you get into it and you've been there a while, you become very disillusioned with the whole thing.
Apart from Tony Blackburn, he's not leaving radio at the minute.
No, he's certainly not leaving. I hope not. I hope that will never... It will never happen. He will never give up those radio jobs. He will never, ever give them up, I swear. Because that it's probably the most important thing, along with his children, in his life.
He's on so many stations, though, isn't he?
I know.
Mean, he's on Radio London. You know, he's on Metro 2 Radio up here.
Is that the Sunday afternoon thing? Is that the Sunday afternoon thing he's on there? Is it the Golden Hits or something?
Sunday afternoons. Yes.
Sunday afternoons, yes, yes. That goes over a lot of the northern stations, yeah.
All right, is that network, does it?
I think so. I think that's the one he's on, yeah. The Greatest Hits Hour or something like that. Not the Radio 2 thing. There's something he does on a Sunday afternoon. I think 4 till 7 or something like that. And he's on all these stations up north, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't actually rate him as a presenter, but
Okay.
I've got my favourites.
That's fair enough. Yeah, fair enough.
Ian Collins last night.
He's at the top of the tree for me. Ian Collins, LBC, excellent show. Excellent show. Really like him. I tell you, I can't stand on LBC. James O'Brien. Oh, he gets on my nerves. He does. He's on now.
Oh, my God, I love James O'Brien.
Do you? Oh, can't bear him.
He's brilliant.
He comes across as one of those alpha males. I don't like that sort of person, do you? I'm not one, you know, that's how it is. Well, thank you for calling in today, Mike. Lovely to hear your voice.
Thank you so much.
Say hello to Mrs. as well.
Hello, Sarah, who's in Chingford in London.
Chingford. Oh, is she with us as well today? Hi, Chingford. Cheerio, Mike.
Thanks, Chris.
Bye now. There we are. Mike calling in from Newcastle this morning. That's nice, isn't it? Have you got any of those dodgy texts that you want to tell me about this morning? 020-8144-3477, or you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. Here's some of the other texts that people have sent to people accidentally. One of my students accidentally emailed me a Harry Potter fanfic instead of her thesis paper, and it's actually really freaking good. I should be grading essays, but instead I'm on chapter 3. Here's another one. Today at work, I emailed a colleague named Susan and actually called her Sushi. Oh, you don't want to be touching any of that nasty stuff. Oh, no. Sushi. No. Nasty. Uncooked fish. How can you sit there eating uncooked fish? Full of microbeads, incidentally, according to the Daily Mail a while ago. Accidentally sent my boss a voice recording of me saying, I hate my job. Do be very, very careful who you send those messages to. Okay? Any other messages you want to tell me about this morning? Call in now, 020-8144-3477. Let's go back to some of your text messages coming in on the show this morning. Good morning to Elaine, who says, hi, Chris. How are you, my friend? I miss your shows. I'm always at work when you're on and can't fully enjoy you. We can always watch the recording later, Elaine, or just have it on in the background. That's the beauty of this show, is generally you don't have to be watching it. You can just have it on in the back. Well, I'm offended, actually. I am offended by being on in the background. I should be on in the centre of your living room where you're paying full attention at some time. Yes. Good morning, Alan Russell, who's with us. Adam says, wow, Mike's call was very clear. What phone is he using? He was probably using Skype and a microphone, actually, I would guess Mike was using. Do let us know, Mike. I think you were using Skype. Justin says, put those rubber gloves on you have in your bedside cupboard and remove the batteries. Wipe the compartment with wire wool, then it's as good as new. Thank you, Justin. Yes. Look, battery acid coming out, my darling. That's what that blue is. that will have to be repaired because not working anymore. The Dalek has been silenced. Oh, no. Please destroy me, Dalek. Look, nothing happening. I'm not being destroyed. There's a few people like to be me destroyed. Tweety Charlotte says Daleks are dangerous. Well, they are, especially if there's leaking acid coming out of their dear. let's have a look. Justin said, didn't I buy you that Dalek many years ago? Yes, of course you did. My little Dalek, of course you did. You see, I have everything on display here. Everything, almost. That's it. There we are. Yes, look, there you go. Mike was using Skype and an SE2000 microphone. I don't know what that is, but it sounds very, very expensive. Thank you very much for that, Mike. Now, George Michael's funeral just around the corner. And in this morning's Sun, I'm trying to work out, and perhaps you all know what this is, I'm trying to work out what they're talking about here. In the Sun this morning, George Michael's burial plot at Highgate Cemetery is reportedly under 24... Oh, has the funeral happened? Has it happened yet? I don't think it's happened. I don't think this has happened yet. Anyway, George Michael's burial plot at Highgate Cemetery is reportedly under 24-hour surveillance as his family prepare for the singer's funeral. And of course, you remember that terrible day, Christmas Day last year, when I shall never forget that, actually. Now, I'd been at my sister's. I generally, when I go up to my sister's, I rent a caravan up there because I like to have my own front door, my own almost house. Well, they are little houses, kitchens, bathrooms, toilets. It's all in there. Television, it's all in there. And I'd been at my sister's house all day for Christmas Day, which was wonderful. They're always nice when I go up there, but a particularly nice Christmas Day for some reason. Can't put my finger on it. I think probably because the little children, are all a little bit more grown up now, you know, 3 and 4 years old, and I can muck about with them more. And that's what it is, because I have honestly never grown up. I get miserable. I do get miserable when I'm on my own. When I'm on my own, sometimes, like yesterday, I was a bit miserable yesterday, I think. I was a bit miserable yesterday. I'm not really happy today, you know. I didn't feel a show yesterday. So you've got the beauty of being unscheduled is that if I'm sitting here and talking to you, I will have felt the show before I've actually come to talk to you. Does that kind of make sense? You know, if you don't feel it, there's no point in you doing it. It's not like a job. So when I'm sitting here talking to you, I have felt, yeah, there's something to do today. Let's just go and do it. And that's how it was. But it wasn't like that. I didn't feel like that yesterday. But certainly the Christmas day and then after I left the house, I think it was about 11 o'clock, I got back to my caravan on Christmas night. And I thought I'd record a show. So I've set up and I record shows on this. If I'm out of the studio, I record them on this. So I've got that in front of me. And it's got the little screen there. Oh, there's a message there. What's that? Oh, okay. Sorry. John's number came up then. I nearly displayed you John Springate's phone number then. Just a minute. Let's get that off there. So there's my... So the screen was... excuse me. So the screen would come up like that, yeah? And then I'd have my... video camera. That's what I see in front of me. Oh no, that's what I see in front of me. Okay. Is that on the right way around? A minute. Anyway, that's better. That's what's in front of me. See, there's the little camera that I talked to you on. That's it there. That's how I'm talking to you via that thing. And there's the other things in front of me here. Okay. I can see what's going on. There's the George Michael story on a computer there. There's a little meter there going up and down. Oh, you can't see that, can you? 1 minute. Can you see that? You can't really see that, can you? No? Can you see that meter going up and down there? Let's come in a little bit closer there. No, you can't, can you? Anyway, so that's in front of me there. But I don't turn off the news stories. So while I'm talking, news stories, if they're like news flashes, urgent stories, will flash across the screen. So I'm chatting away. Yeah, I had a nice time and the children were opening up. And suddenly, across the screen, and George Michael found dead. Anyway, and I thought, I was shocked. I can't remember whether I actually referred to it on that Christmas day or not. or whether I just continued doing the show and then looked at it afterwards. I was really shocked by that. Really shocked by that. And, of course, you know, the tune immediately, Last Christmas in Your Head and all that. I mean, you'll never be able to listen to that now, will you, without realising that the great George Michael died on that Christmas Day 2016. We'll never forget that. Never, ever forget that. Anyway, back to the story. Security at the North London Cemetery have taken preparations to protect the site as the Wham Stars fans flock to pay their respects. According to the Daily Star, the cemetery have ramped up security as George's family fear ghouls could ruin the funeral. Ghouls, G-H-O-U-L-S. And this is the bit I don't get. What do they mean by ghouls? I mean, I thought ghouls was like ghosts. Isn't that like ghosts, you know, ooh, and all that business? I don't understand what they mean by that. The funeral is believed to be taking place today after Kate Moss was forced to pull out of boarding a flight to India at the last minute as details of the service were circulated to his family and friends. It's also been reported that his close friend, Jerry Halliwell, will give a reading at the funeral. Well, as long as she doesn't sing. As long as she doesn't sing. It's raining men, dear me. The Sun also exclusively revealed George has left his £10 million mansion to his favourite older sister, Melanie Panayiotou. It's a Greek name. Not very good at reading foreign names. Apologies for that. Who's 55, who's already moved into the Highgate home. Oh, that's nice, isn't it? Leaving your family, stuff like that. It's also believed the family are planning a Mother's Day memorial for the singer after he is laid to rest beside his beloved mother. So that's the story there. But what do they mean by ghouls? Does anyone know that? I mean, when I read that story in my innocentness, I suppose, I imagine when they said ghouls, does that mean that people will go round there dressed as ghosts and go, ooh, like that? Because that's what I thought. That's what I thought. Anyway, so it looks like the funeral is going to happen today. So we all hope that goes very well. And, you know, he was extremely popular. I loved him. I thought he was fantastic. Fantastic singer. The most modern song of his, because I was a big Wham fan. I went to see Wham at the Hammersmith Odeon. I did, yeah. I think I was one of the only boys there. It was all these screaming girls. And him and Andrew Ridley, they came on in kind of a football kit. And he had yellow, I'll never forget, he had yellow shorts on. And he was putting shuttlecocks down his shorts, then taking them back out again and batting them into the audience. God, that was so long ago. I think it must have been about 21, 22, something like that. Massive show. It was a really good show. I always remember that. And warming up the show was Gary Crowley, who's on BBC Radio London. And he had this, like, this radio. I can't remember what he was doing now. Was he just playing songs and dancing around the stage? And every now and again, it was a big, big radio in front of him. Every now and again, he'd go back to the radio and pull up another aerial. And this radio in the middle of the stage had all these aerials sticking out of it. Very, very strange. But very, very sadly missed George Michael far too early. Far too early. God knows what wonderful music that we have now been deprived of because he's gone. You know, I don't think a musician ever runs out of tunes in their heads. A little bit like a writer. I don't suppose they ever run out of stories. It's not something you retire from, is it? You know, if I was being paid to do this show, I don't think I would be thinking, oh, right, well, I've only got to do this for 5 more years, then I can stop doing it. Then I won't need to do that now for the money. I don't think I'd think like that. It's the same as my karaoke stuff. The karaoke stuff I do in the quiz night, you know. It's not like, oh, I've only got to do this for another 2 years. Oh, then I can retire and I won't have to do nothing. No, it's not that sort of job. It's not that sort of thing. It's a total and utter passion. What? May I call myself an entertainer type person? It's a passion for what we do. The money is secondary. The money is absolutely secondary. And I can say that because there's a lot of people, a lot of writers, radio people, especially radio people, they make sod all. They make Soddle. You'd be very, very surprised. Your little independent local radio person or community radio people, a lot of them don't get paid. They're sitting there doing a show and they don't get paid. Writers, you know, they're not all Terry Pratchett or Mills and Boone people earning thousands and thousands of pounds. There's much more of them earning barely enough to get by, if that, and they have to have other jobs. That's how it is. It's a passion. It's not a job that you look forward to retirement in. So there we are. Justin says, ghouls are people who will try and dig him up. Seriously? Why would you want to do that to someone? Oh, that's just sick, isn't it? It happened with Elvis. That's why they moved him to Graceland. What, they dug him up? I didn't know that. Oh, that's weird, isn't it? That's weird, that is. Justin also says, calls on his iPhone 7 mobile telecommunications device work perfectly. It must be just the 7 Plus. Do you know what I think it is then, Justin? It's the size of the actual phone. It's got to be the size of the actual phone. That's the problem, I reckon. Because it is difficult to hold that great big iPhone 7 Plus, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, thank you very much to Mike for providing the picture of his microphone, which if you're watching the show live, you will be able to see there. Oh, that looks very nice. Would you like to see mine? Do you want to see my big one? Stop it. Stop it. Here's mine. There's mine. Look, comes off like that. There we are. That's mine. Does that make a difference if it's off? You probably get a little bit more popping, don't you? So it's got this big hat on the end of it. This is actually quite old, Mike. This is from my old CMP radio. I actually prefer the look of it like that. But I don't think it's... We'll put the hat back on. It probably sounded a little bit louder like that as well, didn't it? Yes. good. Now, how are we doing on time? Oh, we better disappear, boys and girls. I think we better disappear. Oh, and there's another... I keep getting requests, endless requests from scantily clad women. And more people are getting these now. Let's have a look at this one. What's her name? Her name is Else... that's my text number. Else K. N. Okerson, who lives in Frimley. Well, she don't look like any of the girls that I know in Frimley, I'll tell you that now. I'm a hot brunette who can offer you a piece of paradise. Come in, you will not be disappointed. And then there's a link. I'm now getting about 10 of those a day. It's ridiculous. I used to report them all, but I don't bother anymore because no one seems to do anything about it. Anyone else getting those? Hundreds and hundreds of them a day. Tens of them a day. Anyway, tens of them a day. All right. Justin's off to the CAF in the DeLorean, as we've never been there. Will you enjoy the Ace CAF? Is that one of those greasy spoon CAFs you're going to, Justin? Is your mum with you? Hello, Sylvie. Sylvie's there as well, I think. All right. Okay, let's do today's birthdays, boys and girls, and then we're going. Don't forget, it's karaoke tonight. I'll tell you about that a little bit later on. Happy birthday today to Damian Wall, Greg Orsic. Oh, that's a name enough. Now, where are you, Damian? Wow, that's a name, isn't it? You play the guitar anyway. It doesn't say where you are. Happy birthday to you, sir. OK, here's all the birthdays coming up now, boys and girls, all right? Happy birthday today to Martin McManus, who's 28 today. Happy birthday, Martin. Bill Scows, 65 today. You've got the record of being the most years today. Congratulations to Bill Scows. Bill Scows, 65 today. Fabrice Perret, happy birthday. Tony Aubrey, a very, very young 52. Younger than me, Tony. Happy birthday. And Craig Steele tonight. Is 37 years old tonight. Oh, is that your little boy there? Oh, bless him. Look, happy birthday, Craig. Sitting in front of your Christmas tree as well there. Let's sing you the song.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Damian, Martin, Bill, Fabrice, Tony and Craig.
Happy birthday to you.
All right, gang. Enjoy your birthdays, boys and girls. Perhaps you'd like to celebrate tonight with me. at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. Yes, it's Monday night, and I'll be hosting karaoke tonight at Central Station in King's Cross from 8 o'clock until 11:30 p.m, boys and girls. It's cheap drinks as well there tonight, every Monday. Okay, so cheap drinks and karaoke tonight, every Monday at Central Station Bar, Wharfdale Road, King's Cross in London. It starts at 8 o'clock, all right? That's it today. Thank you very much for watching and listening to the show, boys and girls. I'll see you again very soon. Get out there in the sunshine. Cheerio now.